Welcome and thank you for joining the webinar today. I'm Amanda Jadro, the Director of Portfolio Management with TRICOM. As an administrative and financial solutions provider to the staffing and consulting industry, it is our philosophy to be an active member of the staffing industry by staying abreast of the ever-changing marketplace. For that reason, TRICOM was pleased to launch the Industry Insider webinar series designed to share our expert knowledge and resources with our fellow staffing industry colleagues. One of our core values is to build relationships and become a leading resource to staffing and consulting firms nationwide. Our presenters today are BJ Hoffman and Michael Klein with Citroen Cooperman. BJ Hoffman is a tax partner with over 23 years of experience in the areas of audit, tax, litigation, and litigation support. He serves clients in a wide range of industries, including closely held entities in the staffing, healthcare, franchising, as well as law firms. Michael Klein, a tax partner, has more than 30 years of experience providing a wide array of tax and consulting services. Leading the Philadelphia Office Tax Service Group, he serves as an advisor to clients in a range of industries, including healthcare, manufacturing, distribution, staffing, real estate and technology, and he also leads the firm's Tax Quality Control Committee. Citroen Cooperman is among the largest nationally recognized full-service accounting, audit, tax, and business advisory firms in the United States, currently ranked in the top 25. With locations across Northeast, Citroen Cooperman has steadily built its business, serving a diverse and loyal clientele since 1979. Their daily mission is to help clients focus on what counts. They enhance the business and personal lives of their clients through a customized approach, which includes offering a wide range of attest, assurance, tax, and business advisory services, including validation and forensic services across the globe. Citroen Cooperman has deep experience in a variety of industries, including entertainment, financial services, franchising, healthcare, private equity, real estate, staffing, and technology. Citroen Cooperman is an independent firm associated with Moore Stephens International Limited. In today's edition of the Industry Insider webinar series, BJ and Michael will explore the most consequential tax reform in 30 years with discussions on 2018 tax planning opportunities, new regulations, potential uncertainties for staffing companies. By the end of this session, you'll know the impact of the major tax reform. If you have any questions during the presentation, please utilize the Q&A feature located on the right toolbar. After the presentation, there will be time for questions and an opportunity for you to give us your feedback on today's webinar by completing a short exit poll. I will turn the floor over to BJ and Michael.
Thanks a lot, Amanda. Good afternoon, everyone. I am BJ Hoffman, as Amanda mentioned, a partner in the Philadelphia office of Citroen Cooperman. We're so happy to be joining TRICOM today to discuss the 2017 Tax Cuts and Jobs Act, which is really a monumental piece of legislation that in many ways alters the landscape of tax planning and tax strategy. To some degree, staffing companies in some respects are left in limbo, but we'll discuss some of the aspects of that as we proceed here. Joining me here today, again, as introduced, is Michael Klein, my partner, who will no doubt interrupt me periodically, and I will do the same to him. So say hi to Michael.
Good morning. Good afternoon. And I look forward to interrupting.
Thanks.
Like I just did.
Exactly. Just 5 seconds of additional commercial here for Citroen Cooperman. We provide provide accounting and tax services and consulting services to more staffing companies than any other firm in the country, all shapes and sizes and across all geographies. So with that, we will jump in. Amanda, as I see here, as I'm looking, I'm not so sure I'm seeing our PowerPoint. I'm seeing the TRICOM deck up here. There we go. Perfect.
All right, give me back and check. There you go.
Thank you very much. So I'm going to, with that, jump in, talk to everyone about the individual tax changes. Michael will focus on the corporate tax changes, and then we will both collaborate and speak to you about what I'm sure everyone in the staffing industry is most interested in, which is pass-through entities and the potential pass-through tax exclusion, 20% pass-through deduction. So with that, we'll move ahead here and start talking about individual taxes under the new law. Forgive this busy screenshot here, but this is essentially what we're looking at as far as the tax rate changes. So the Tax Cuts and Jobs Act, which was signed into law in December of 2017, happened, was enacted within 50 days, which is an extraordinarily short amount of time for comment and analysis, and as you might imagine, is a process so fast that it's susceptible to errors and certainly areas that are vague in nature that are going to need continual ongoing guidance from the government and from experts. So, but in general terms, the Act served to lower tax rates and widen tax brackets. So without getting into too much detail on the brackets here, I'll call your attention to the very bottom line here, which is the highest tax rate. The left side of the screen, left-hand side of the screen, is the pre-2018 rates. And as you'll see in the lower left-hand corner, previously the highest marginal tax rate was 39.6%, which applied to married taxpayers that had taxable income in excess of approximately $470,000 a year. In the new law in 2018, on the bottom far right, you'll see that the highest bracket doesn't kick in until marrieds hit $600,000 of taxable income, and that maximum rate is now 37%, which is a drop of more than 2%. And throughout the tables, you'll see the widening of the brackets and generally a lowering of the rates, which is superficially good news for most taxpayers. As an example, and this is an example for someone that's in a relatively high-income tax state. So think New York State, think California, New Jersey, Connecticut. This schedule illustrates the differences under the new law compared to the old law. The average married taxpayer with some investment income and a couple of kids and some fairly robust real estate taxes, if that taxpayer is at the $400,000 taxable income level, they stand to save approximately $19,000 under the new law. And at the bottom of the screen, you'll see someone that was making or is making $3 million a year stands to save about $4,000 a year under the new law. And that's kind of, I would think, counterintuitive. You know, one would think that the higher the income number, the more the tax savings. So what's going on here? Under the old law, the $400,000 a year earner was not able to effectively deduct state, local income taxes, and real estate taxes because of the presence of the alternative minimum tax, or AMT. We're not going to get into too much detail there, but the AMT served to curtail the use of that tax deduction by those in the $400,000, $500,000, $600,000 range a year in taxable income. Those in the higher echelons of making millions of dollars a year, especially in a high tax state, were really getting huge, huge write-offs and benefits out of the deduction for state and local income taxes and real estate taxes. Under the new law, although the brackets have now dropped for both of those taxpayers, the $400,000 taxpayer and the $3 million taxpayer, because state and local taxes are no longer generally deductible by anyone anymore, the high-income taxpayer is really taking a blow. And though, their tax is coming down, they're also losing the benefit of some pretty hefty deductions, whereas the $400,000 taxpayer, you know, was never really effectively getting the benefit of those deductions anyway, so they are reaping the benefits of the lower rate. So that's kind of what's going on there. To the extent that someone's also living in a high-tax city, they may find themselves actually paying more under the new tax law, which is an unexpected detriment to those in cities like New York City, for instance. But most taxpayers will see some tax savings. So let's talk about the new law. Things that are gone. Personal dependency exemptions for your kids, they're gone. As we've just explored, the state and local income and property taxes are, though not gone, they're now limited to $10,000 a year, which, again, is a severe curtailment of what was previously a big tax write-off for many taxpayers. Incidentally, the fact that many of these deductions for state and local taxes and real estate taxes have gone away may open the door for you to explore with your tax preparer, where possible, the adoption of a home office, if it's appropriate, because real estate taxes associated with that home office would not be subject to any limitations. So certainly something to explore if it's possible. A lot of the miscellaneous itemized deductions are gone also. Tax prep fees, investment advisory fees, unreimbursed employee business expenses, and certain other expenses that were previously theoretically deductible are gone, although many taxpayers were not able to take advantage of those deductions anyway because of the alternative minimum tax. Still, they're gone. The shared responsibility payment, which is the Obamacare individual mandate, that penalty, in 2019 disappears. So if you don't have health insurance coverage as an individual in 19, whereas you may have paid a penalty before, there is no such penalty for the individual taxpayer anymore. Alimony, whereas historically alimony payments have been deductible by the payor of the alimony and includable as taxable income by the recipient of alimony payments. For 2019 agreements enacted in 2019 and moving forward, they're no longer tax deductible and taxable income. So there's a bit of a rush, theoretically, for people to get their divorces in place in 2018 so that they can take advantage of some of the tax benefits of alimony rules. Things that have changed. So here's a big one. As I'm sure most of you are aware, mortgages, historically you've been able to write off your mortgage interest, at least to the extent that you have mortgage indebtedness of less than $1 million in aggregate, you've been able to take a write-off generally for the interest that you've paid. While those mortgages are still grandfathered in, and moving forward while they exist, you'll still be able to take a write-off for that. For new mortgages in 2018, or at least post-enactment of the new law, that limit now drops to $750,000 a year. So one for new mortgages can only deduct the interest associated with the first $750,000 of aggregate mortgage indebtedness. Home equity lines of credit are still theoretically deductible as mortgage interest, but only to the extent that the proceeds of the home equity loan are used to acquire, construct, or substantially renovate the property. So, for example, if you borrowed on a home equity line and used it to buy a car, the interest associated with that loan will no longer be deductible in any way, shape, or form. Other items that have changed. Medical expenses. Medical expenses have usually been difficult to take advantage of, unreimbursed medical expenses, because you only get a benefit to the extent that those unreimbursed medical expenses exceed a pretty substantial percentage of your adjusted gross income a year. That threshold has dropped a little bit and it's bounced around, but now it's back to 7.5% is the floor. So you need to incur unreimbursed medical expenses in excess of 7.5% of your adjusted gross income before you get any benefit out of that. That's down from a 10% floor. The standard deduction has now doubled for married taxpayers to $24,000. And what this effectively means is that more people, more of the average Joe who may have a W-2 salary and maybe a little bit of charity and maybe a small mortgage, some real estate taxes. Now they're not going to need to track those miscellaneous, those itemized deductions, and instead it'll behoove them and be more beneficial for them to claim the standard deduction. What this does open up to us as a planning opportunity is the timing. We control the timing of some of our deductions, and it may be beneficial to bunch some of our deductions into a single tax year so as to make use of both a standard deduction in certain years and the itemized in other years. For example, super simplified example, but let's just say you're a taxpayer who only has year in and year out $23,000 worth of charity that you give away and no other itemized deductions. Well, if you have the choice of taking a $23,000 charitable deduction or the $24,000 standard deduction, you're going to take the $24,000 deduction every year, year in and year out. But if you can bunch 2 years of charity into one and have $46,000 worth of charity in year one, you're going to take that charity, that deduction of $46,000 in year one, and in year two, then you'll take the $24,000 standard deduction. So there's some timing and evaluation that should be reviewed with your tax professional in terms of timing. And there are ways in which you can effectively time the deduction of certain deductions like the charity through donor-advised funds, whereby you can bunch and front-load a lot of contributions into 1 year and spread out the disbursement of those to charities over several years. So that becomes an attractive mechanism for deductions moving forward. The child tax credit increased and became a little more refundable. Probably not going to get into the stock options discussion here as it's beyond the scope of what we're talking about. But here's one for staffing companies. The last two items, losses and net operating losses. So it's not uncommon if you as a staffing company are in growth mode and you are borrowing from the good people at Tricom, for instance, to fund your payroll, to fund your temps, and you're in growth mode, you are borrowing to pay deductible expenses. And when you're in that mode, it is not uncommon to show cash basis tax losses as you grow year in and year out and to accumulate those losses. And we have many, many staffing clients that will reflect annual cash basis tax losses because of the way they're deducting their payroll expenses. Well, now under the new law, you are obligated to aggregate all of your business losses, not just from the staffing company, from any other businesses you have, passive or active, and to the extent that that bunched pool of operating losses exceeds $500,000 in a given year, that excess is not available to offset other interest, dividends, W-2 income in that year, but is rather carried forward to subsequent years for use later as a as an NOL, net operating loss. Similarly, those that have pre-existing net operating losses that are created after this law goes into play in 2018. Whereas you might be able to generate big-time net operating losses and not pay any, historically have not paid any federal taxes for many years moving forward until you ate up those NOLs. Well, now, under the new law, you're only going to be able to offset 80% of your income, your other taxable income, with those NOLs. So even if you have huge NOLs, you are still going to be paying year in and year out some federal taxes in all likelihood. So you need to be prepared for that. I should note that pre-new tax law NOLs are still able to be used and freed up to offset fully your taxable income. So it's only for newly created NOLs that this limitation comes into play for 2018 moving forward. So that's an area that is of note to our growing staffing company clients. Altmin, alternative minimum tax, we touched on to some extent when we talked about how the new tax law affects the $400,000 taxpayer and the $3 million taxpayer. What the alternative minimum tax is a shadow tax system. It's a different way of computing your tax, and you pay the higher of regular taxes, or AMT, year in and year out. What tripped people up historically was big real estate and state and local taxes, miscellaneous itemized deductions, dependency exemptions. They would often throw people into the AMT. And since those deductions are no longer really deductible at all, far fewer people are going to be subject to the AMT in any event moving forward. So it becomes much less of an impact anymore. And therefore, we're not going to spend a whole heck of a lot of time on this. I should also note that for those of you in the light industrial space, you should absolutely be making use of the Work Opportunity Tax Credit, the WOTC. And I should note, though, that there was talk of the WOTC being eliminated. It was extended under the new tax law. So definitely be looking in the WOTC area if you're in light industrial. That is the highs and the lows of the individual changes. So with that, Michael's going to talk to us about the changes on the corporate side, the business side.
Uninterrupted, too. I didn't interrupt
that
you at all.
That wasn't bad.
So.
Yeah, I'm surprised.
Yeah, I should take the tape off my mouth, though. But let's go through. We'll go through the corporate changes. Some of these may, if any of you are C corporations, these will certainly apply to you. Some of the provisions that we're going to speak about will also apply to pass-throughs. So we'll go through them. The ones that we there are many changes. We're going to just highlight the ones that we feel are appropriate and applicable to the staffing industry. First one, this was the crux of the entire tax change, was to get corporate rates lower. Therefore, as a result, Congress lowered the tax rate from a high of 35% to a flat rate of 21%. And we say flat rate because previously the corporate rates were a graduated system similar to the income tax individual rates with lower brackets, medium brackets, and then 35%. Now all corporations will be taxed at a flat 21%. The chart here is just to show you that if you are a fiscal year filer, you're going to need to prorate the tax change for the amount of your year that falls into 2018, so it's just a weighted average and just a good chart to have to see where your tax rate's going to be. So moving on, this is a quick schedule. So as PJ just alluded to, there also was a corporate alternative minimum tax that shadowed the corporate tax in the past, but now Congress eliminated that AMT tax. So corporations, C corporations are no longer to be subject to alternative minimum tax, and therefore going forward, though, if you had paid minimum tax in the past, you will be eligible to get 50% of that back in a carry forward, and then after years beginning in 2021, the refundable amount will be 100%. So if you are a C corporation and you have paid that in the past, you speak to your tax advisor and look into getting the credits back. Okay, so this one could be significant to the staffing industry. What Congress did was, and many think that this was put into place because they have Congress's belief that the nation has and its businesses have too much debt. So they what they're doing here is they're capping the amount of interest expense that's deductible by a business. This also applies to not only C corporations but to all pass-through type entities, so partnerships, S corporations, and LLCs. What's happening here is the interest expense deduction for business going, if the business has gross receipts in excess of $25 million over the three preceding years, then they'll be subject to this interest expense deduction. The deduction is limited for interest expense to 30% of a business's adjusted taxable income. So if a business had net income of $1 million, they would, prior to deducting interest, they'd be able to deduct $300,000 of interest. Any excess gets carried forward. Adjusted taxable income is the way that's defined in the new code is you take taxable income, and there are certain add-backs. You would certainly add back business interest, expense, and income. You would add back any net operating losses taken. You would add back the 20% pass-through deduction that we spoke about. And for the first couple years, because the IRS doesn't want this to be too much of a pill to swallow. For years prior to 2022, they're allowing you to add back depreciation and amortization. So basically, you're looking at an EBITDA formula in order to get the amount that you're using to determine the limitation. The good news is it's for businesses that are only over $25 million. Now, just keep in mind that if you own several businesses and they all have common ownership, then you'll be forced to aggregate all those businesses together in order to determine whether the businesses' gross receipts exceed $25 million. If combined they do, then you're going to have to apply this interest expense limitation to all of the entities that are involved. Now, for pass-through entities, this determination will be done at the pass-through level, not up at the individual level. Any excess interest that is not deducted, however, will get passed up to the partners or the shareholders of the pass-through, and they'll have to track that as a carry forward. And then in years going forward, when there's excess income, they'll then be able to use those losses. So once it's determined that there is a limitation, all the carry forward information will be held up at the partner or shareholder level. So it's just another reason why you should be using TurboTax, or better yet, you should use a public accounting firm to help you with your tax returns. This is going to make it somewhat complicated. For those of you that are in the real estate industry also, they did put a special carve-out in there for real estate, and mainly because under the $25 million exception, if a company or a pastor is considered a tax shelter, if they have receipts under $25 million, they're still subject to the interest expense limitation. So that is really all of your real estate entities, rental entities that are considered tax shelters. And those businesses are allowed to elect out of this and take the full interest deduction in return for giving up some beneficial depreciation policies that we're going to talk about next. So good news is the real estate lobby was strong here, and they were able to find an out for their clients. So going forward, the real estate industries won't be limited to the interest expense limitations. My opinion that almost every real estate industry client will elect out of this interest expense. So moving forward, some of you may have had this the DPAD deduction, which is the domestic production activity deduction. That has been repealed for 2018 going forward. The pass-through deduction that we're going to speak about in a couple minutes, the pass-through deduction was to replace this deduction. So Congress gives and they take away at the same time. So no longer have to keep track of this. Okay, so this was a big change for the IRS. If any of you were on the accrual basis, which for a staffing company, I wouldn't think that many of you would be. However, for those companies that were forced to be on the accrual basis because their gross receipts exceeded $10 million, the IRS has now lifted that threshold to $25 million. So if you're a taxpayer and your gross receipts are less than $25 million for the prior 3 years, you'll be permitted to use the cash method of accounting. This is very beneficial for growing businesses that have larger receivables, and it just allows them to create larger and larger deferrals, which in tax planning and tax, in our game, tax deferral is always the name of the game. As long as we can defer income, we're happy. So this allows many other companies to be eligible for using the accrual method. And so that was something to highlight. And so BJ is going a little quicker than I am, but that's fine. Now go back. We're good. Go to the next slide, please. So meals and entertainment, this is a big change for many businesses. So in the past, meals and entertainment were both subject to the 50% disallowance. So if you took a client to a baseball game or out golfing, the cost of that was always 50% deductible. Also, if you took them to dinner and discussed business, that expense was also 50% deductible. However, under the new law, starting in 2018, the entertainment portion is no longer deductible. So if you take a client golfing, that no longer is deductible. If you take your client to a baseball game, no longer deductible. What still is deductible, and this has been a source of some differing opinions, but we believe still that any meals that you have with a client remain 50% deductible, and any meals that you have with your employee, if you take them out to lunch or dinner, that is also deductible as long as business is being discussed. If, however, you are providing meals to your company to the employees, then that used to be 100% deductible. So, in other words, if your staff is working late and you bring in dinner for them, in the past that was 100% deductible. That's now going to move to 50% deductible. And then in years after 2025, then that will no longer be deductible at all. But we'll see how long that – we'll see if it makes it that long. I have a feeling that deduction may come back. And then the other controversy is, what about holiday parties and stuff like that that an employer wants to do for his employees? And as you can see here, as long as it's open to everybody, then it remains 100% deductible. The areas that we're seeing some disagreement on are gray areas. Is if you take your client to a baseball game or a football game, whatever, and you have dinner at the game, is the dinner still deductible, or is it just part of the entertainment expense? So we're seeing a lot of differing opinions. A lot of people are leaning towards it's not deductible. However, if you took your client to dinner before the baseball game and then to the baseball game afterwards, that we believe there's clear guidance that says the dinner is deductible because the entertainment portion hasn't started, and then the baseball game, of course, would still remain non-deductible. So what I think Congress thought was going to be clear-cut is a little somewhat foggy still until we get real determinative guidance from them. But right now everybody's kind of digging in deep to the code and the congressional reports to see exactly what they were thinking about this. So I think to be totally safe, I think you would go to a meal prior to the game, and then any meal, anything that you eat at the game will be hopefully de minimis and wouldn't be subject to the wouldn't be deductible at all. So the deductions for providing qualified transportation fringe benefits no longer deductible. Moving along. Okay. So just quickly on bonus depreciation, I know most of the staffing companies are not very capital intensive, so kind of want to go through this rather quickly so we can get on to the really good stuff. Just keep in mind that Congress really loosened up the depreciation rules, and this was one of the only ones that was retroactive. This went back to 9/27/2017. So what they're saying here is if you purchase any fixed assets with a life of 20 years or below, which is all your computers, cars, furniture, fixtures, and even leasehold improvements, although there's some controversy with leasehold improvements, but all that would now be 100% deductible in the first year. So if you buy, 50 computers at $1,000 each, that's $50,000, you'd be able to write the whole thing off in the first year. So that and prior to this year, bonus depreciation was 50%. Additionally, bonus depreciation was only allocable to new property. Here they've really loosened it up, and they've allowed it to be used against used property. So if you bought a used car or I don't know if you ever buy a used computer or used furniture, but you would be able to write the whole thing off in the first year. Clearly, you can. Congress would allow you to elect to stay at 50%. I'm not sure why you would do that, but you can. Just quickly on the one area with qualified leasehold improvements. In the past, qualified leasehold improvements, which would be improvements done to the interior of a building, either by the lessor or the lessee, were subject to 15-year life and therefore were allowed to be taken as bonus depreciation. So in the past, if somebody spent $100,000 on leasehold improvements on their office space and they were leasing that space, they would be able to write off half of the cost, which was fairly good deduction for, you know, what used to be 39 years, to be able to take 50% in the first year and the remaining out over 15 years. Well, Congress wanted to try to simplify this area because there was all different types of qualified property. There was qualified improvement property, qualified leasehold improvement property, qualified restaurant property, and so on. And so what the IRS did says, we're going to put this all together and we're going to call it qualified improvement property. Under the definition previous to the tax change, qualified improvement property was leasehold improvements done by the owner of the building, not subject to a lease. So if you owned a building that housed your business and you did leasehold improvements, in the past, you'd be able to write off 50%, but the other half would be depreciated over the life of the building, which was 39 years. So in their haste to make everything called qualified improvement property and allow it to be subject to bonus depreciation, they said, all right, all leasehold improvements are qualified improvement property, but they never changed the life in the definition of qualified improvement property from 39 years to 15. As a result, right now we have a big blunder or error in the act that says if you have leasehold improvements, they're not subject to bonus depreciation because qualified improvement property is a 39-year property and not a property under a 20-year life. If then what they should have done is said qualified improvement property is a 15-year life, and then we'd be able to write off everything. So what we're saying, we're hoping there's a technical correction coming out, but if you've done significant leasehold improvements in your space, you may want to talk to somebody about this to see exactly what deduction you may be getting or you may not be getting based on whether they make this change. Go ahead, Beach. Okay, so Section 179, expensing. Just quickly, this allows you to write off new property or used property. This was way before bonus depreciation came into play, but the rate for this increased from $1 million to $2.5 million. There are reasons why you would want to do Section 179 as opposed to bonus depreciation of 100%, but I think at this point, I think we'll skip over that as I don't think it's that important. Luxury auto limitations. So in the first year, you can take $10,000 of depreciation in the first year for a luxury auto limitation, which I believe will get you, for $10,000, will get you a Ford Focus, which you'd be able to write off in the first year. Any other car, you would have to wait till the second, third, fourth, or fifth year to get the rest of it. Moving along. Just quickly, many of you may have heard of like-kind exchanges. Like-kind exchanges were on the chopping block. However, Congress pulled that back, and in another victory for the real estate industry, like-kind exchanges were held in place for real property, but any other type of property, the like-kind exchanges are no longer allowable. Okay, R&D expenses. In the past, you were able to write off R&D expenses if you weren't taking the credit. Now the IRS is forcing you to capitalize these expenses and amortize them over 15 years. So there's a change in how these things are going to go, and this applies to all expenditures subsequent to years after 2021. And just keep in mind, R&D credits are still available. And if many of you probably are the R&D credit is something that is available to you because if you're changing any of your processes in your computer programs that you're using, your scheduling programs, if you're making any of those changes, that could be subject to the R&D credit, and you may be leaving some credits on the table. So that's something you may want to talk to your tax advisor about as well.
Yeah, just to jump in, to the extent that you're customizing and not using just off-the-shelf software for applicant tracking, you know, there's an opportunity to take a peek here to see if you're eligible for the R&D credit, which is better than the tax deduction. So if you're not taking advantage of that, speak to your tax advisor. Sorry, Michael.
Nope, no problem. Okay, moving along. Yeah, here's an interesting one that may be very where another way place you may be leaving money on the table. If you have an eligible employee, for every eligible employee, you're permitted to claim get a credit of 12.5% of their wages that you pay them for a period in which they're on the family or medical leave. So if the qualifications are you have to offer this to all full-time employees for at least 2 weeks of annual pay on family or medical leave, and you also have to offer it to part-time employees based on the pro rata amount of time they work during the year. So if you have this program in place for all employees and it's documented in your employee handbook or in your governance documents, then you definitely can take advantage of this credit. It's fairly significant at 12.5% of wages for the 2.5 weeks, 2 weeks. So something you should be looking into, or if your family medical leave policy doesn't include everybody, you may want to take a look at that, because for the small amount maybe that you include everybody, you'll be able to get all the credits for people that are out on leave. So I would keep an eye on this credit as well. Net operating losses. So for C corporations, net operating losses were also limited, as BJ spoke to you earlier. They'll be limited to 80% of taxable income going forward. If you incur an NOL in 2018 and forward, only 80% of that will be able to be used to offset income. If you have net operating losses from years prior to 18, those losses can still be used to offset 100% of taxable income. No longer can you carry back NOLs, except if they're prior to 2018 NOLs, as you can see here. If it's prior to 2018, you get a two-year carryback, carry forward 20 years, and then it expires. For losses incurred after 2018, there's no carryback. You can only use it against 80% of taxable income, and there's unlimited carry forward. Okay, BJ, you spoke about this, so let's move on.
All right. Here's the moment you've all been waiting for, I think. The pass-through discussion, and just to define pass-throughs, I'm sure predominantly all of you are probably pass-throughs, either operating as sole proprietors, S-corporations, LLCs, LLPs, you're all pass-throughs. So the new tax law brought into play the Section 199 deduction, which is more commonly referred to as the 20% pass-through deduction. So just to make sure we're all talking about the same thing, if you have $300,000 of revenues in the year, $200,000 worth of business expenses, you're left with $100,000 of taxable income that would probably flow through to you on a K-1 form, a tax K-1 form, and there's the notion that perhaps 20% of that $100,000 or $20,000 might escape federal taxation. That's what we're talking about here. That's what everybody's focused in on. So the question is, does this deduction, do staffing companies qualify for this pass-through deduction? So here comes the drum roll. Are you eligible to take advantage of this? And the answer is, we don't know. Sorry, guys. As we mentioned, the law was really thrown in place within 50 days and left a lot of areas vague, including this whole notion of who is eligible and who is not for this 20% pass-through deduction. Right now, we're waiting for further guidance from Treasury. There are pretty aggressive lobbying efforts underway by the ASA, for sure. I was talking to TechSurf earlier this week. They've got a lobbyist involved. Everyone's trying to shoehorn the staffing or the industry is trying to shoehorn itself into this deduction, the answer is we don't know whether ultimately you will or will not be eligible for the deduction. So Michael's going to discuss the mechanics, but let me talk about some generalities first so that we're, again, all on the same page. Certainly, if your household 1040 income for a married couple is less than $315,000 a year, you are going to get that 20% pass-through deduction. No ifs, ands, or buts about it, okay? You're going to get it. The question is when you're making, as a married couple, north of $315,000 a year, and specifically, there's a phase in and phase out, but if you're making more than $415,000 a year as a married couple on your 1040, there's a litany of other restrictions that theoretically come into play. Certainly, if you're in that bucket, there are certain industries that are clearly not eligible for the credit, for the this 20% pass-through deduction. Those that are clearly not eligible are accountants, lawyers, doctors, and consultants. Okay? There are those industries that are clearly eligible, no matter what, for the deduction, subject to a few limitations. Those are manufacturers or those involved in real estate investment. Those industries are clearly going to get the deduction. Then there's this whole vague area, and I'm going to actually read the language of from the law that indicates that those who are not eligible, in addition to the consultants. So there's this following language. Any business where the principal asset of the business is the reputation or skill of one or more of its employees. Now, what does that mean? Totally unclear. One might say that that is a definition that applies to most all service businesses, and staffing is a service business. So that language might preclude staffing companies from taking advantage of the 20% pass-through. A couple of other things to think about here. So, is a staffing company a labor consulting firm? And as a consultant, should it be excluded from this 20% pass-through? Well, probably not. I mean, you're not in the business of consulting necessarily. You're more in the business of providing labor. So you may be okay there. Are staffing companies a business where the principal asset is the reputation or skill of its employees? See, to me, that's a tricky one, and that may be problematic here. If it is a company where the principal asset is the reputation and skill of its employees, you may be knocked out of this deduction. Finally, do you need to drill down and determine what kind of staffing you're providing? For instance, if you are providing medical nurse, travel nurses, or legal temporary staffing, because you're in legal or because you're in medical, are you specifically precluded from using that exclusion, the 20% pass-through deduction? The industry is arguing, A, first of all, you're not consultants, and therefore you provide staffing services and not consulting expenses, services rather. The industry also says that you're also providing staffing services and not legal services or medical services or anything else, so you should apply. Or be eligible for the deduction. There's the question, many staffing companies refer to their temps as consultants, but they're not really consultants, so that should not preclude you from taking advantage of the pass-through. I think a lot of it just depends on the interpretation of whether or not you're a business where the principal asset is the reputation or skill of one or more employees. It's funny to hear the lobbyists for the industry, when they're speaking to you guys and out loud, they're generally optimistic and they're, speaking to the fact that they have tentative acceptance and agreements from Washington that the law was intended to keep staffing companies eligible for the deduction. But in private, one-on-one, when I talk to the lobbyists, they're much more guarded and hedged about whether ultimately the staffing industry will be eligible or not. So we're told that late summer we should get some more guidance from Treasury and the IRS and Congress, late summer, early fall. So what that means and what we're telling our staffing clients right now is you need to stay nimble for 2018. And what does staying nimble mean? Well, what that means is if you're an S corporation trying to pay the shareholders reasonable W-2 salary like you're required to, but let's not overdo the salary. Let's try to keep it at a sort of a minimum base. So that would allow us to have as much as possible flowing through to us on a K-1 as business income from your pass-through entity at the end of the year, so that if you're eligible for the 20% pass-through, you're going to be able to maximize that deduction. Similarly, if you're an LLC or an LLP, if you're getting guaranteed payments from your entity, you want to try and minimize those as well. Again, to maximize the amount that's going to flow through to you as ordinary business income on a K-1 later, and to maximize the amount that you're going to be able to shelter with a 20% pass-through exclusion. So I wish I had more details or guidance to give you, but at this time we're just saying to our clients, stay nimble and watch the papers, watch the news, watch the industry, and maybe by the end of the summer or early fall we'll get some more guidance, and then we can be really quick to take advantage of it one way or the other by the end of the year. So with that, let's assume that you are eligible for the 20% pass-through. Michael's going to talk about the mechanics of the deduction and show you how it works.
You don't want to do the whole thing, BJ?
Well, no, I'm out of that.
Okay.
All right.
Okay. So, BJ, you can just push it up two slides, two more. Next one, yeah. So, yeah, BJ, go back one. Yeah.
There you go.
BJ spoke to you. So here's the actual formula that we're going to use to determine whether you get the 20% deduction. If you are eligible for the 20% deduction, this is the formula that you're going to go through. Keep in mind, as BJ said, if you're married filing jointly and your income is under 315, taxable income is under 315, or single and it's under 157, none of this limitation applies. Either you don't have to worry about getting over the qualified business hurdle, and you don't have to get over this formula hurdle. You'll get the deduction, the 20% deduction. So, but how do we calculate the 20% deduction? So let's look at this formula. It says the sum of the lesser of, which is already confusing to me, but 20% of the taxpayer's qualified business income. So basically, your qualified business income is the income that you, if you have several different types of income within the entity, the qualified business income is the net income from the business that qualifies. I'm defining it using the words, but it's a business that qualifies for this limitation. So to qualify for the limitation, you can't be one of the excluded services, which BJ spoke to you about. That would be healthcare, legal, accounting, and then any other type of business where the skill or reputation of the employees is part of the business. So if you're not one of those, then you're a qualified business income. So what the calculator is, you take 20% of the taxpayer's qualified business income, that or the lesser of that, or the 50% of your W-2 wages. Okay, so if you made $1 million of net income, then 20% of that would be $200,000. If you had less than $400,000 of wages, which 50% of would be $200,000, if you had less than that, then the 50% of the wages would govern, and that would limit how much you could deduct. So if you had $1 million of taxable income and only $300,000 of wages, you would be looking at 20% of taxpayers' qualified business income of $200,000, or 50% of wages, which is $150,000. So the $150,000 would be your limitation. So Congress didn't stop there, and as I mentioned before, the real estate lobby was very strong here. So the real estate lobby said, "Wait a minute, we really don't pay that much in wages. We want something else." So the Congress came back and said, "Okay, we'll give you 20% of your qualified business income, or the lesser of 25% of your W-2 wages, plus 2.5% of unadjusted basis of qualified property." So if you're in a rental business, your qualified property is your entire building, and you'd be able to take 2.5% of the purchase price of the building And if that is, you know, so and that was more than enough to offset the not having any wages. Most real estate rentals don't have any wages. So this was a way to have the real estate industry participate in this deduction and also to throw give them a break. Now, just to key in on the W-2 wages, keep in mind that the W-2 wages have to be from the actual business that is getting the deduction. So if you have a number of companies set up and one company is paying the wages for all the companies and you're just allocating the wages to the to other company, other related companies, those allocated wages do not count for the other entities. Those entities will be considered not having any wages. There is some relief, though, if you're using a PEO. PEO wages paid from a PEO are qualified for the business that is utilizing the PEO. So if you have a situation, though, where you're allocating wages, you may want to start paying separate payroll in all of your separate entities so that you do get to take advantage of W-2 of this 20% deduction. So let's look at a couple examples. I know it's a lot to digest, but let's look at a couple examples here to make it – I just want to clarify or crystallize a couple points. So here you have a sole proprietor, Mickey. He's an attorney. And as you remember, attorneys are not subject to the 20% deduction because it's legal services. So Mickey made $500,000 as a sole proprietor. Mickey does not get the deduction. This is because his ceiling – he's single of $207,500. He's over the ceiling of $207,500 of taxable income. So he is over the threshold. So and he's in an disqualified business, so he gets no deduction. Now let's take Minnie, who's also an attorney. She only made $100,000 as a sole proprietor. She doesn't pay any wages. However, because she's under the threshold of $157,500, she gets to take the full deduction. So even though she's has no wages and she is in a disqualified business, she doesn't need to jump those hurdles because her income is lower than the threshold. So she'll get the full deduction. So let's go to the next examples. So you have a couple, Jack and Jill. They own an S corporation. They sell buckets that generate $500,000 of qualified business income. And of that, they have $220,000 of wages, which they pay to themselves. So if we assume their taxable income for Jack and Jill is in excess of $415,000, then their deduction under 199A will be $100,000. So again, we look at the lesser of 20% of qualified business income, which is $100,000, or 50% of wages, which is $110,000, so of course they would get the lesser of the two, which is $100,000. Now here's just a slight change. What if Jack and Jill were partners in a partnership or partners in an LLC? Jack and Jill sell the buckets, they generate the same $500,000, and they each take, instead of salary, which they're not able to take, they take $220,000 of guaranteed payments they pay to themselves. They have no wages to anybody else. If we assume the taxable income, again, is in excess of $415,000, which is the threshold amount, their 199A deduction is zero. And that's because you take the lesser of 20% of qualified business income, which is $100,000, or 50% of wages, which is zero. So what does this tell you? This tells you if you're in this situation similar to Jack and Jill, you may really want to look into converting to an S corporation. While it's not as flexible as a LLC or a partnership, it does allow you to take wages, and it does will then avail itself to the 20% deduction. Keeping in mind, you would probably still need some clarification from Congress as to whether your staffing business is even subject to this. So I wouldn't be hasty to convert until I found out whether I was even eligible for it or not. But that's something to keep in mind. Apparently, we're open for questions.
Yes, we are. Obviously, it's a very complicated set of laws, and as much as the intention was to simplify the tax code, for some it does, but for many, it's going to cause you, to really dig in with your professional and explore, the best structure for yourself. So it should keep accountants busy, which is good for us, but you know, I'm not so sure how good it is for everyone else.
All right, so we're going to go ahead and open the floor for questions. So please submit any questions you have in the Q&A feature or the chat feature. I'm going to go ahead and open up a poll so you can give us some feedback on today's webinar. One question that has come in, it's related to the S-Corp and a C-Corporation. I'm currently an S-Corp sole owner, but with the new tax laws, is it better to go back to being a C-Corporation?
It's a great question, and it's a question that we've covered in other seminars where we've had some additional time. But just quickly, as in almost any tax answer to any tax question, the answer is going to be it depends. But in generally, I'm very against converting to a C corporation for any number of reasons. But I'll give you the top three reasons. One, if you are a C corporation, then your net income, as you probably are alluding to, will be subject to a lower rate. The corporate rate, individual rates are 37. I can pay tax at 21%. Why wouldn't I just be a C corporation? What we don't take into account under that scenario is then when you take the money out, that's considered a dividend to yourself, and that is now subject to 15 or 20%. So if you take 21% for the net income that you're paying tax on, and then let's say 20% to take the money out of the company as a dividend, now you're up at 40-41%, which is higher than if you were an S corporation. So you have that to take into account. The second thing is there's always state issues as well. Here in Pennsylvania, an individual is taxed at 3%. But a corporation is taxed at 10%. So while you may be saving on your conversion from S to C for federal, you may be giving a lot of it back at the state level, which may negate any benefits that you're getting at the federal level. And third, and this is a little long-term thinking, but if you ever sell your business, mostly 99% of the times, if you sell your business, somebody's going to buy the assets of your company and not the the stock. So if you're a C corporation and someone buys the assets out of the C corporation, then C corporations do not have a preferential capital gain rate. So one, you'd be paying 21% instead of potentially 20, not a big deal, but then you got to get the money out of the company. So whereas if you owned an S corp, you'd pay 20% and on the capital gains there, and then that would be it. Whereas federal, you'd pay 21%, but then you take all the money out, and as I alluded to, you'd pay an additional 20% on the dividend. So and then if your company's S-Corp is subject or can take the 20% pass-through deduction, that makes the argument even stronger to stay an S-Corporation. So I really wouldn't, in most cases, I am telling my clients not to do it. You don't want to make a mistake by doing it without taking advice, because if you do terminate your S election, you can't reelect for 5 years. So it's not like you can do it and then immediately change your mind and go back. So if you do want to do it, please make sure that it does make total sense. Haven't come across a scenario yet where we've wanted to convert to C.
Great answer. Thank you for covering that so thoroughly. And if you have further questions, I highly suggest talking to BJ, you know, one-on-one, or Michael, you know, to reach out to them and get more information on your specific circumstances. Do you have any takeaways that you can provide, you know, as we're wrapping things up here today, that they should take into consideration, just some kind of final thoughts?
Well, I guess the final thought is as we already mentioned, it's a complicated set of new tax laws. There's a lot of changes. You really need to have an ongoing discussion with your tax professional, hopefully someone that knows the staffing industry, both to monitor what's going on as far as the pass-through deduction and to help you navigate planning opportunities for the year end. If you're just talking to your accountant in February, March, and April and getting your tax return done for a fee, well, I mean, there's a value to that. But I think that, you know, where we accountants like to be and position ourselves is to be there with you throughout the year, certainly to be with you in October, November, December for tax planning. And, of course, the prerequisite of an accountant is the ability to prepare a tax return. So there's so many changes, and this is a bit of a superficial approach today. It's all given the scope. The scope is limited here. The time, just have that discussion. Have that discussion with your tax professional. It's so important. So.
Very good. Well, thank you all for your time. I know we're going a little over here. So, again, if anyone has any additional questions, I've put the contact information up on the screen, so please feel free to reach out to them directly. I'd like to thank our participants in today's webinar, as well as BJ and Michael from Citrin and Cooperman for sharing their knowledge of navigating the Tax Cuts and Jobs Act, a primer for the new 2018 tax laws. We'll have a recording of this webinar available on our website at tricom.com. It's under the Resources and Industry Insider Webinars tab. Thank you again for your participation, and watch for information on our next monthly webinar session. Have a great day. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Thanks.